of the lines that struck me as we were singing now is, and I've never really, thought about it, but in the Yahweh song, it says, the one who is to come, the one who,
wait,
there's the last.
Was and is to come.
There we go. He was and is to come is the one who lives in us. And I thought that it just struck me for the first time, actually hearing those lines, because we're so used to talking about God being the one who is, the one who was, the one who is to come. And suddenly this realization of, but he's also here with me, in me, right now. It was just beautiful. In October 2021, I approached John Morley and I asked him to teach me to surf. A year and a half later, and I'm still not fantastic, but the question is, am I a surfer? That's the real question. Personally, I don't yet feel like one. I'm not going to lie. But according to John, if you stand up on a board three times, you are a surfer. Three times for more than 5 seconds, he says. If you stand up on a board for three times for more than 5 seconds, you're a surfer. I think it's just, I mean, you've all met John. The man is a very excitable person. And I think he's trying to get as many people hooked on surfing as possible. And so this is an easy entrance into the sport. However, there's a video on the Christian Surfers International YouTube channel where the international director of Christian Surfers, his name is Roy Harley. He's based in Jeffreys Bay. He says the following. He says, a surfer is something you become. It doesn't just happen. It's not standing up in the white water on a learn to surf board. It's on the other side of countless reef cuts, hammerings, and hold downs. That's where the surfer emerges. So I find myself in this weird spot where I'm able to stand up on a board, and I've done so more than three times. So according to John, I'm a surfer, but I've not yet earned my stripes as a surfer. And I think that's a healthy place to be in. You see, you get people who classify themselves as surfers. They say they've spent years honing their craft and all these things, and they've adopted all the surfer language and all the surfer attitude that goes with it. But it's often the negative side of surfing which they adopt. The selfishness that's in the water. Now, for example, if you're not a surfer, you won't know about this. But if you think logically about it, a wave only exists once. Any type of wave only exists once. And if you're a surfer, particularly if you're a good surfer, you want the best wave. And so there's this immense selfishness that happens in the water of, this is my wave and you do not take it from me. So you've got that kind of, that selfishness that is often adopted. There is the judging of those who are learning to surf, almost as if these surfers just were able to stand up on a board from the moment they came out the womb and never went through the learning process. But there's this judging of those who are learning to surf, as opposed to correcting them and helping them and teaching them. The correction of these wrong actions is often then done in quite a rude or sometimes violent way. And stakes are claimed in localism, they call it. So Big Bay is not such a problem because it's a learning to surf beach. But there are some surf spots that it's like, this is our surf spot. You do not belong here. Why are you here? Get out the water. And they sometimes physically attack people sometimes as well. And they think they have the right to this because they are surfers, because they've got this title, surfer. And it can be problematic for anyone who gains an identity and thinks that now that they have this identity, they are set, they are untouchable. Another very good example to use is the person who calls himself a Christian, and they will often say, I go to church every Sunday, and they might even claim to have said the sinner's prayer at some point in their life. But the combination of these two things, or they say the combination of these two things, this makes them a Christian, they are saved, you know. But the reality is, God has never worked like that, and he never will work like that. He cares about the condition of a person's heart, not the physical location of your body or ritualistic prayer. that is kind of just said out loud, right? But there's this, you know, there's that idea of like sitting in a church doesn't make you a Christian, just like sitting at McDonald's doesn't make you a hamburger. Like that idea that exists there. And it's a true fact because it's about the condition of a person's heart, not just having the title. All right? Are our hearts turned towards God or only our kind of personas that we want to portray and show to the world? This is the same problem that the people of Israel in the Old Testament faced, where they said, well, because we are Jews and God has chosen us, and we are his chosen people, we are already saved. We can kind of do whatever we want because, well, God has chosen us. He signed the deal. But that's not the case. You see, constantly, throughout the Old Testament, and specifically through his prophets, God called the people of Israel to repentance and to a changing of their hearts. He warned them of the coming judgment if they do not change. They are not sorted because of their birth. They cannot claim the title of God's chosen people and live however they want, just as a surfer cannot claim to have the title of a surfer and just do whatever they want in the water. And so we're going to read today quite a long passage, so bear with me. We're going to read from the book of Joel. I'm going to talk a little bit because if you're opening up a Bible, you might not know where exactly to find it. So it's in the Minor Prophets. Use your contents page if it's there for a reason. Don't feel embarrassed. So we're going to read from the book of Joel. We're going to read from chapter 1, verse 1, all the way to chapter 2, verse 17. Now, the reason why I've chosen this book, and we're going to preach the book over the next 3 or 4 weeks. The reason I've chosen this book is because we have Pentecost in about 4 weeks' time. And Pentecost, the passage that Peter quotes, that he says, your old men will dream dreams, young men will see visions, that comes from Joel. And so I was like, it would be interesting to look at this full book. What is the whole book saying? And then when we travel towards Pentecost and just after Pentecost, seeing just how this all works together and what God is really saying and doing in the space. And so we're going to read from Joel chapter 1, verse 1, all the way to chapter 2, verse 17. So bear with me. But this is the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord came to Joel, son of Pethuel. Hear this, you elders. Listen, all you who live in the land. Has anything like this ever happened in your days or in the days of your ancestors? Tell it to your children. Let the children tell it to their children and their children to the next generation. What the locust swarm has left, the great locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have left, the young locusts have eaten. What the young locusts have left, other locusts have eaten. Wake up, you drunkards, and weep. Wail, all you drinkers of wine, wail because of the new wine, for it has been snatched from your lips. A nation has invaded my land, a mighty army without number. It has teeth of a lion and the fangs of a lioness. It has laid waste to my vines and ruined my fig trees. It has stripped off their bark and thrown it away, leaving their branches white. More like a virgin in sackcloth, grieving for the betrothed of her youth. Grain offerings and drink offerings are cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests are in mourning, those who minister before the Lord. The fields are ruined, the ground is dried up, the grain is destroyed, the new wine is dried up, the olive oil fails. Despair, you farmers, wail, you vine growers. Grieve for the wheat in the barley, because the harvest of the field is destroyed. The vine is dried up and the fig trees withered. The pomegranate, the palm, and the apple tree, and all the trees of the field are dried up. Surely the people's joy is withered away. Put on sackcloth, you priests, and mourn. Wail, you who minister before the altar. Come, spend the night in sackcloth, you who minister before God. For the grain offerings and the drink offerings are withheld from the house of your God. Declare a holy fast, call a sacred assembly, summon the elders and all who live in the land to the house of the Lord your God, and cry out to the Lord. Alas for that day, for the day of the Lord is near. It will come like destruction from the Almighty. Has not the food been cut off before our very eyes? Joy and gladness from the house of our God. The seeds are shriveled beneath the clods. The storehouses are in ruin. The granaries have been broken down, for the grain has dried up. How the cattle moan. The herds mill about because they have no pasture. Even the flocks of sheep are suffering. To you, Lord, I call, for fire has devoured the pastures in the wilderness, and flames have burned up all the trees of the field. Even the wild animals pant for you. The streams of water have dried up, and the fire has devoured the pastures in the wilderness. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy hill. Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is close at hand. A day of darkness and gloom. A day of clouds and blackness. Like dawn spreading before the mountains, a large and mighty army comes, such as never was in ancient times, nor ever will be in ages to come. Before them fire devours, behind them a flame blazes. Before them the land is like a garden of Eden, behind them a desert waste. Nothing escapes them. They have the appearance of horses. They gallop along like cavalry. With a noise like that of chariots, they leap over the mountain tops like a cracking fire consuming stubble, like a mighty army drawn up for battle. At the sight of them, nations are in anguish. Every face turns pale. They charge like warriors. They scale walls like soldiers. They all march in line, not swerving from their course. They do not jostle each other. Each marches straight ahead. They plunge to the defenses without breaking rank. They rush upon the city. They run along the walls. They climb into the houses like thieves. They enter through the windows. Before them the earth shakes. The heavens tremble. The sun and moon are darkened, and the stars no longer shine. The Lord thunders at the head of his army. His forces are beyond number, and mighty is the army that obeys his command. The day of the Lord is great. It is dreadful. Who can endure it? Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your heart, not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. Who knows? He may turn and relent and leave behind a blessing, grain offerings and drink offerings, for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, declare holy fast, call a sacred assembly, gather the people, consecrate the assembly, bring together the elders, gather the children, those nursing at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber. Let the priests who minister before the Lord weep between the portico and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, Lord. Do not make your inheritance an object of scorn, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Bizarre reading, I know. People often talk about the doom and gloom of the prophets. Well, we've dived right in. Joel is a fascinating book. It's only 3 chapters long, and it's written by the prophet Joel. And the reason, as I said, why we chose to work with Joel is because, as I said, in 2 weeks' time, we see the quote from Pentecost. coming up in Joel, and it's quite interesting because if you know that quote, it seems weird to have this idea of the young men will dream visions and the Spirit of the Lord will come upon the people, but here's this whole thing about locusts and armies and destruction and the day of the Lord. So just bear with me. We had to read this long chunk just to get the introduction, the scene set. So the book of Joel opens with the words of the word of the Lord that came to Joel, son of Pethuel. Now, if you're familiar with the writings of the prophets, there should be something that should pique your interest in this opening line already. But if you're not familiar with the Old Testament prophets, invariably what you see in the opening line of the prophets is the mention of the name of a king during whose reign the prophet spoke and during whose reign the prophet ministered. But if you look at Joel, there's no mention of a king. So we're already left with an interesting situation, which is, when was this written? Because this is bizarre. Because normally you rely on the names of kings to say, oh, well, Joel was written in this and this, and so therefore he spoke during this time, because this is when the king reigned. But we don't have that. So Joel mentions no king, and there's no other thing mentioned in the book to pin down the exact date for when Joel spoke, other than this plague of locusts that appears in the first chapter. But there's no historical written thing saying, on this year this locust plague came. So we don't know when he wrote. So we are left at the very beginning of the book with a decision to make. And that is, when do we believe Joel to be written? And that leaves us with two options. The first option is that Joel might have been written in about the 9th century BC. Okay, so 900 BC, somewhere around there. When Israel technically had a king, they had the king Joash, but he was a child and he didn't really have any political power. His uncle by marriage, who was also the high priest at the time, Jehoiada, he held the real power in that moment. So we can say, well, Israel had a king, but he wasn't really operating as a king, so maybe in the 9th century, about this time, that's when Joel was written. The other option is that it was written in the 4th century BC, long after the Babylonian exile, where there's also no king in Israel. The reality is, when Joel was written isn't too much of a problem. We don't have to stress too much about it. But it just does make interpreting some passages interesting. So, for example, there are some passages in Joel that are the same wording as some passages in Amos and in Isaiah. So if Joel was written in the 9th century, then Amos and Isaiah are quoting from Joel. But if it was written in the 4th century, then Amos and Isaiah are quoted by Joel in his book. So you've got like something interesting like that happening there. Also, and I'll get to this soon, there is in a part of Joel chapter 2 which very clearly references the Babylonian army attacking, which then makes us ask, is this passage a forewarning to the people of Israel of what is to come, or is it an explanation of what happened? So you see, in the grand scheme of things, it doesn't really matter when it was written, it just makes interpreting the book interesting. So don't let the fact that we call prophets prophets obscure the decision that you make. Remember, biblical prophets are very different from our understanding of prophets today. Biblical prophets were not known primarily for foretelling the future. The role of a biblical prophet, if you recall our series on Jonah from last year, was to bring the word of the Lord to the people, to warn them of what the actions might result. If you keep on doing this, this is going to be the result. If you keep on turning away from the Lord, he'll send destruction and judgment and all those things. So that's what the main role of the Old Testament prophets were. There were elements in the prophets' writings and in what the prophets said of foretelling the future. We know this, which is why you might say that You might prefer to say that Joel was in the 9th century, because then he was foretelling what would happen to the people. But there were also elements that the prophets would then challenge the Israelites of the actions and explain to them why God has done something when he's done something, which is why you might want to favor having the 4th century interpretation and say, well, he's explaining and he's challenging them and saying, God's done this and this is why. I personally do have a preferred time of writing, but I'm not going to tell you what my preferred time of writing is. I want you to decide for yourself. All of this so far, and we've just spoken about the first verse of this 3-chapter book. So now we're going to speed up a little bit. So after introducing the prophet, the book begins, and it tells us of this plague of locusts which has come upon Israel. It's tempting. The first time I read Joel, I wanted to interpret this plague of locusts as a figurative plague, some imagery here. It's tempting to do so, but it is most likely that in this case, Joel is actually talking about a real plague of locusts that has come upon the land, that has just devoured everything, destroyed the crops, destroyed the trees, left the olive oil gone. That's why the drunkard is mourning, because the vines were destroyed and the drunkards can't get drunk anymore. The priests are mourning because there's no more grain offering to give. There's no more things to make offerings at the temple with. The farmers are mourning because of the destruction of the harvest and of the income. So we're taking this initial plague of locusts, not as a figurative thing, but actually as a literal plague that has come upon the land. Joel then calls the people to begin lamenting, to cry out to God, telling the priests to call the people together, for the whole land to cry out to God together because of this destruction. You might remember a service last year where we spent some time lamenting as a congregation. The act of worship through lamenting is a lost art in the church today. And I deliberately use the word art. I think there's something deeply profound and beautiful when people together cry out to God, either literally weeping or just noting when something bad has happened. And so Joel calls the people to come and do this, to come and cry out to God, because not only is there no longer food for the people, there's now no way to make offerings to the Lord, and even the cattle and the sheep are suffering because there's no food for them, the water's dried up, just everything and everyone in the land is suffering. What's really quite cool, and this is the challenge with preaching, if I could say this, is you so often, when you're writing a sermon, you'll use the word you. You need to go home and do this. You need to repent. You need to do this. You need to do that. And the worries, the issue there is if you use that all the time, you exclude yourself, the minister excludes themselves from what is being said. So you lot need to go home and do this, but I'm fine, don't worry. And really what you should be saying is we need to go and do this. So Joel calls the people, he's called the priests, get the people together, get the babies, let's all start lamenting. But then what's really quite powerful is that Joel himself, at the end of chapter 1, joins in the lament. So he didn't just say, you lot go and lament. He said, all of us, including me, let us lament. So he says, to you, Lord, I call, joining this cry to God for the suffering of the land. So this is what's chapter 1. We come to the second chapter. Now we have this idea of the army of locusts continuing. But this time round, Joel uses the literal language that was unpacked in the first chapter to create a base for which to talk about the locusts figuratively. Okay? So we know the locusts literally happened, but now he says, now there's something else that's going to come, like a plague of locusts. So chapter 2 opens with this blast on the trumpet and an alarm going out because, as verse 1 says, the day of the Lord is coming. I've explained the day of the Lord before in a sermon, and I'll elaborate on it in the coming weeks. But for now, the main thing to know about the Day of the Lord is that it is language which is used in the Old Testament, particularly by the prophets, to tell of a day where both judgment and restoration will happen. It is finds its origins, the idea of the Day of the Lord finds its origins in the Exodus story, where judgment was brought on the people of Egypt, but Israel experienced restoration. So this idea of like, Egypt was judged with the plagues, particularly with the final plague, the plague of the firstborn, and Israel was redeemed and they were restored. And so throughout the Old Testament, the Old Testament prophets, they take up this idea of the Day of the Lord, and they start speaking about it a lot, all right? Because what you start seeing is the Jews, as I said earlier, believed that they were untouchable. We are God's chosen people. He will never punish us, okay? And so we are always going to be the ones who are going to be redeemed. And if you read the Old Testament, poor Israel, even still to this day, this nation is permanently being oppressed, okay? So this language of the Day of the Lord comes up because they're like, oh, the Lord will come and bring judgment on the enemies, but he will restore us. And so this is going to happen, and the Day of the Lord will arrive again. He will judge our enemies and restore us. He'll judge our enemies and he'll restore us. He'll just keep doing that. But the prophets in the Old Testament start taking this idea of the Day of the Lord and they turn it around towards Israel. And they say, if you don't fix your lives, the Lord's judgment isn't going to come upon somebody else. It's going to come upon you. The Day of the Lord is coming for you. And if you read Joel, it comes up two or three times already in the passage that we read. And he says that this terrible day will come. The Lord will judge you. But the Day of the Lord is not just about judgment. It's about restoration. So the Lord will come. He will judge you if you don't change your heart. But he will also restore. And so the prophets take this language and they start telling this to the people of Israel. So Joel warns people, the Day of the Lord is coming. Sound the alarm. Judgment is on the way. An army will come like the locusts came and it will destroy everything. And the most frightening idea comes a little bit later on in chapter 2 of our reading, where God is said to be the head of the army. Okay? And just to clarify things, Joel doesn't just say Elohim is the head of the army, like God, like it could be just some random God. He very clearly states Yahweh, the Lord, your God, he is the head of this army. He is the one leading this situation, leading this judgment upon his people. And this army will be like cavalry, which at that point was the most fearsome part of the army. Because if all you had was a sword and hopefully a spear, how do you stop a horse charging? You can't. So this idea of this cavalry just coming, this army, just coming, this galloping horses, and all the land is then destroyed in its wake. We then get this frightful statement and rhetorical question in verse 11 of chapter 2. The day of the Lord, more specifically, the day of Yahweh, is great. It is dreadful. Who can endure it? Who honestly can endure the judgment of God? It's a rhetorical question because we all know what the answer is. No one. So what are the people to do? The locusts came and destroyed the crops and they suffered. Imagine what suffering will be like, what the suffering will be like after this army. You suffer after the locusts. This situation is going to be worse. What is going to happen? What are we going to do? God is leading this army. He's passing judgment on Israel. He's destroying everything. What can they possibly do to prevent this? Verse 12 begins the answer for the people. It starts with, even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. The use of even now is wonderful for me because it shows God's grace. It's not too late. Even now you can repent. Even now, with the day of judgment coming, the people can turn to the Lord, but they must return with their whole heart. They must repent sincerely for what they must have done. They must, as verse 13 says, tear or rend their hearts, not just their clothes. This isn't just a case of external proof, but rather internal. The Lord knows the hearts of his people. Their hearts need to be torn for mourning and repentance, not just their clothes. If they return to the Lord, they will find him to be gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. A quote from Exodus, if I may add. And who knows, if they turn to him, he may then turn his judgment away from the people if they repent honestly. And he will turn away. Instead of leaving destruction, he might actually leave a blessing. So the trumpet which was blown in Zion to announce the coming army, the trumpet that was used as the alarm, will now be blown to declare a fast and a gathering of the people. Just as Joel called the people to gather and lament after the locust invasion, so the people must gather again. Everyone from the priests to the children to the mothers still nursing their babies, all of Israel must gather and lament and repent. They must once again cry out to God to save them, so that the world will know who God is, as opposed to asking, where is their God? So, the question from all of us, you've done well, you've listened well, thank you very much. I know it's a lot and it's weird. But the question from all of this is, what does this mean for us? Because it's all nice, but what does it mean? We have not experienced a locust invasion which has left us hungry. We are not facing a potential judgment army led by God, which we need to repent. Except we do. Remember I said at the beginning of the sermon, a surfer who says, I'm a surfer, and adopts all the negative behavior will never, by me and by many other surfers, be respected as a surfer. Because if you are just a not nice guy in the water, I was about to say not a worse word, but if you're just a not nice guy in the water, no one's going to like you. No one's going to want to surf with you. Get out. I don't care how good you are. Don't be in the water. Okay? And the same goes for the Christians. You think that because they go to church on a regular basis, who's done the sinner's prayer, is saved. Those are external things. Those are the garments we wear. The real question is, what is the state of our hearts? You see, according to 2 Peter, the day of the Lord has once again happened. And it happened when Christ was crucified for our sins. Judgment was passed, and the verdict is, no one comes to the Father except through Jesus. So we need to check our own hearts on a regular basis. You know, complacency is a terrible thing for Christians. When I arrived in Goodwood Presby, apparently, this is the legend that was going around. So Colin Campbell's the minister there. I worked with him for 4 years. Wonderful, wonderful minister. Some of the pews had those old wooden pews. Not the most comfortable of pews, let's not lie. Some of them had cushions, but they were old, they were tattered. Some of them were just not cushion, had no cushions. The legend that I heard, although Colin has subsequently denied saying this, who knows, is somebody said, oh, we should make cushions for the pews. And Colin said, no, because a comfortable Christian is a dead Christian. And I was just like, oh, yeah, he's not wrong. Complacency in a Christian's life is a scary, scary thing. And we need to check our hearts every single day. If our hearts are not in line with God, We must do as people did, and we must lament, and we must repent, and we must rend our hearts, but not our clothes, and we must turn back to God. The final day of the Lord is coming. We spoke about this, I think, 2 years ago when it came to Christmas time. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Okay? South Africans, remember we spoke about what does now, not now, just now mean? Soon and very soon, when it comes to the Lord, has a varying time frame. But all we know is soon, Jesus is coming. So the final day of the Lord is coming, where the final judgment will take place. Those not with God will face destruction, but those with the Lord will be redeemed. So we check our hearts and we find that they are in line with God. The next thing is to be the prophets God wants us to be in the world, to go and proclaim His word to friends, to family, to strangers who do not know who Jesus is, to call them to repentance, to rend their hearts, to turn to God and be saved. If you found that the sermon this morning has moved you to act, to repent, to rend your heart, feel free to talk to somebody about it. I'm available both now after the service, but also this week I won't be in the office, but after that, you can drop me a message, come and chat with me. I'm happy to pray with you, but I'm pretty sure there's many others in the church that are happy to pray with you as well. Don't let this pass you by, but do the work which God has called you to do. Because you will see in the next two or three weeks when we get to the prophecy about the Spirit coming, what the redeeming part of the day of the Lord actually does for His people. Amen. Thank you very much. You listened well. It was long, but you did well. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank You that You indeed redeem us, that You save us, that You call us to repentance, and that You want a real living relationship with us, not just a superficial one. And so, Father God, help us to constantly do analysis of our own lives with You, to constantly ask the difficult questions and the deep questions. And if we find ourselves drifting or in a place of complacency, may we rend our hearts and come back to You. Father, give us courage also to go and tell others about You, so that Your church may grow and that people will know that Jesus Christ is Lord. Be with us, we pray, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.